Good day. My name is Christian Meuse. I'm one of the cardiologists and intensivists in Erasmus Medical Center. I'm accompanied by my colleague, Dr. Dries Dosreis-Miranda, who's also an intensivist and HEMS physician on the Lifeliner. And we speak also on behalf of Professor Dick Thibault. Today we would like to discuss the topic of ECMO with you. ECMO is an acronym which stands for Extracorporeal Membrane Oxygenation and represents a technique which is able to support patients with refractory respiratory failure or cardiac failure. And what it does in essention is that it replaces pulmonary and or cardiac function temporarily. Currently two types of ECMO. The first of all is veno-venous ECMO, and the second type is veno-arterial ECMO. In the situation of veno-venous ECMO, blood is drained from the right atrium, oxygenated and pumped back to the system, but also in the vein. So thereby it only replaces the pulmonary function. In the veno-arterial setting, the blood is also drained from the right atrium, pumped through an oxygenator, but brought back into an arterial big artery, and thereby also supporting cardiac function. Over the last years, and this is the situation for the Erasmus Medical Center, we have seen that the number of ECMO applications has risen fastly. This is a setting for both adult and pediatric patients, but you see that there's a more or less exponential curve in the number of applications over time. This is also the situation which we appreciate throughout the world. So these are numbers from the International Society for ECMO applications, and there you see the same trend, that the number is fastly rising. It also brings about a lot of costs, and this is the situation in the Netherlands, where it is calculated that for a veno-arterial ECMO, more or less 68,000 euros per run or per patient are being spent each time it is being applied. When ECMO is used in the setting of cardiac resuscitation, then it's about 52,000 euros per treatment. And for a veno-venous ECMO, the costs are larger, but it largely represents also the longer duration of support which is necessary. And if you would add up all these costs for the adult setting, you would end up with a figure of around 50 million euros. The outcomes of patients supported with ECMO, and this is specifically for patients supported with veno-arterial ECMO, has been improving over the last years. Here you see different cohorts over time on the x-axis and the number of patients or the percentage of patients surviving on the y-axis. And there you see that here in the period 2007-2008, you see that overall over 3/4 of a patient dies. And over time you see in the last quarter 2017-18, you see this number decreasing up to around 50%. This improvement largely reflects that we have become better in selecting patients who will benefit from this intense treatment. In infants and neonates, we have also seen increasing numbers of applications throughout time. And also we have seen that mortality rates have declined a little bit. If we consider research, then we have to consider a patient's trajectory. So if a patient comes in the hospital and suffers a severe event, for example, a cardiac arrest, or when the heart suffers a major incident while it's insufficiently working in another basis. But in any way, there's a necessity to initiate ECMO support. Then a majority of patients survives, but also some will die or end up with long-term limitations. Throughout this trajectory, there are some facets which we try to improve in several ways. At the first part is concerning the selection of patients. Specifically, in the subgroup of patients who have suffered cardiac arrest, we have initiated the on-scene trial, which tries to find out the additional effect of ECMO in patients who have suffered a cardiac arrest, but have not gained return of spontaneous circulation after 20 minutes of time. A second project focuses on the ECMO management and also the long-term outcomes of patients related to complications and other happenings during the course of treatment. And this project is entitled Precise ECLS. I will tell you more about that in a second, but first I will give the word to my colleague to tell you more about the first project.
Thank you very much, Christian. I'll continue this webinar with VA ECMO for cardiac failure. And for cardiac failure, the most severe form of cardiac failure is cardiac arrest. And for cardiac arrest, ECMO can be used during the cardiac arrest phase. Here you see a video of an ECMO implantation during arrest. This patient has a severe pulmonary embolism. And the Erasmus has a long history of ECPR, and ECPR stands for extracorporeal cardiopulmonary resuscitation. And our team is readily available 24/7 in the hospital. So if ambulance calls for a cardiac arrest, we have a reaction time of approximately 5 minutes that everyone is sterile and gowns ready in the ER. In this procedure, you'll see that the cannulas are inserted now. They're big cannulas, and they will be connected very soon to an ECMO machine. If the patient is connected to the ECMO machine, then we achieve ECMO blood flow of 4 or 5 liters a minute. That is approximately the native cardiac output, and in this manner the chest compressions can be stopped, and the ECMO has taken over the complete heart or lung function. This can be very fast. On the left you see a picture of the times of a 14-year-old boy who arrived at 1943 at the ER, on the ER table, with his pants still on, so he had to cut off his pants. And 11 minutes later, 1945, you see that ECMO blood flow was started. So this can be initiated very fast. In the history, in the ancient times, until now, patients had to come during cardiac arrest to the hospital, because this procedure could only be done in the hospital. And as you could imagine, only if there is a short period of cardiac arrest time, then ECPR would be suitable. That means that the collapse cannot be very far from the ECPR hospital. In this picture, you see the 11 ECPR hospitals in the Netherlands. And around these hospitals, we have drawn circles in indicating the area in which you may collapse to be still on time to the ER to receive ECPR. And here you see that more than 50% of the Dutch area is not covered for ECPR, meaning that if you collapse outside these areas, you will receive spontaneous recirculation, then you can survive. But if you don't receive any spontaneous circulation, then you won't survive and you don't have a chance to receive ECMO. Time is critical in ECPR. And on the left page, you'll see the how long it takes for basic life support, for the ambulance to have advanced life support, transport time, and time to initiate ECMO. And on average, it takes about 75 minutes between 112 call, the initial alarm call, and establishing ECMO blood flow. So resuscitation time, the time of chest compressions, is 75 minutes on average, if you are going to the hospital during resuscitation. And we think we can improve that. By performing pre-hospital ECPR, this time could be shorter. We have 4 HEMS teams, Helicopter Emergency Medical Services teams, 4 HEMS teams situated in Groningen, Amsterdam, Rotterdam and Nijmegen, and who can be equipped with ECMO. And also the HEMS physician and the HEMS nurse, we are teaching to perform ECMO, so reducing time of chest compressions. And we'll do that in a stepped wedge fashion. Here on this graph, you see on the x-axis, you see the quartiles of the years, and on the y-axis, you see the different centers. all centers start, in this study, all centers start on the same moment with the study. In the gray bars, you'll see the control period. The HEMS will go to the cardiac arrest on scene, but is not equipped with ECMO. And in the step Dutch fashion, every HEMS will convert to having ECMO on board and being able to perform ECMO pre-hospital. Only the time of switch is different for all HEMS stations. On the left side, you see the area that can be covered within 20 minutes of 112 call. So you see that practically whole Netherlands can be covered within 20 minutes that by the HEMS teams. That means that the HEMS within those circles, the HEMS is readily at scene within 20 minutes. That does not mean that the area of Zeeland and Twente cannot be covered by ECPR. It only takes a little bit longer. Within 30 minutes, whole Netherlands can be covered by the HEMS teams within 30 minutes, allowing 15 minutes for cannulation time. It still means that the whole Netherlands can receive ECPR within 45 minutes of chest compressions. And that would be, that would have two major major goals, major advantages. One is that we are now able, with pre-hospital ECPR, we are now able to cover whole Holland instead of only 50% of Holland. And the second is that we are able to achieve ECMO blood flow, so stop the resuscitation after 45 minutes of resuscitation instead of 75 minutes of resuscitation. Here you see a picture of an ECPR implantation at a home, and in the other you see a video of an ECPR implantation. Here on the video you see that the cannulas are just inserted. You see that the clamps are still on. Now he is releasing the clamps and ECMO blood flow is achieved, as you see that the tubing is getting red by blood running through the tubes. And please pay attention to the left arm, which is moving as the ECMO blood flow is started. The main objective of the study is reducing time in cardiac arrest, which is inevitably associated with an improvement of outcome. This is a literature study, a systematic review what we've done, and in the yellow dots you see normal resuscitation without ECMO, non-shockable rhythm, and here you see the time in cardiac arrest on the x-axis with survival on the y-axis, and you see that after 10 minutes the survival is very low. On the blue line you'll see shockable rhythm with normal resuscitation, so without ECMO, and here you see that after 20 minutes of resuscitation outcome begins to decrease, and here you see the red line is ECPR with ECMO, shockable and non-shockable. And you have a reasonable survival after 75 minutes. But if you can improve this low flow time, this time in cardiac arrest from 75 minutes to approximately 30 minutes, your survival will be dramatically improved. Is it possible to reduce time in cardiac arrest? Yes, that is possible. On the left side, you see the timetables of 14 individual patients having ECPR in the hospital. That means that patients are having out-of-hospital cardiac arrest and are transported to the hospital to receive ECPR. And here you see again that median 75 minutes of chest compressions are delivered before getting ECMO blood flow. On the left side, you see our first 8 patients. The blue bars is fly time, and the blue bars green bars is arrival at scene. You have to do some things as an echography, intubation, and just helping the paramedics, and then we can start ECPR. And at the end of the green bars, you'll see a start of ECMO blood flow. And here you see that we have reduced the time significantly for those only 8 patients to 43 minutes. So it's very likely that reduction of time in cardiac arrest will also lead to improvement of survival. Christian, May I give you the floor again?
The second project is called Precise ECLS, and this study focuses on different aspects of ECMO care. The first aspect is patient selection. In a very difficult situation, we are eager to put in ECMO and to try to save patients' lives, but eventually some patients we are not able to help survive in any case. So one of the study aims is to try to optimize our selection of patients in order to improve our survival rates with ECMO and also to improve quality of life on the long term. The second aspect is about ECMO management. Currently, there are a lot of unresolved questions regarding how to tailor ECMO support and medication surrounding ECMO support. And also these questions are being addressed by this study project. And the last aspect of ECMO care drains down to the liberation from ECMO, or landing a patient and trying to wean ECMO, so to stop it. Precise ECLS is currently being run in 6 independent hospitals in the Netherlands. Together, we have to aim to improve ECMO care in different ways and different aspects, as I just mentioned, in the coming years. Also, it is not essential to just improve survival, but also to improve quality of life. And therefore, we believe that neuromonitoring, so keeping a watch on the brain, is essential to improve these outcomes. And this is an example of a baby shortly after cardiac surgery, having suffered cardiac failure, so heart failure, thus severe that it necessitated ECMO support, on whom neuromonitoring is initiated. Neurological monitoring is not only essential in short term, but also in long term. In pediatric patients, but also starting in adult patients now, we are optimizing the long-term outcomes by measuring it also in the long term and describing it, first of all. So here's the example of neonatal ECMO, whereby patients could suffer long-term deficits and outcomes. And in this phase, after longer terms, we are also measuring it at the moment. Another field of great interest is that of pharmacokinetics and dynamics, which is also greatly affected by ECMO. Here's an example of the different determinants affecting pharmacokinetics and dynamics. There's a lot of patient-related factors. There are a lot of drug-related factors, but not to be underestimated are the effects and determinants related to ECMO and the circuit itself. We have described to you several projects which we are undertaking and the efforts which we place to optimize patient outcomes, but there remain a lot of unresolved questions and matters over time. For example, questions relating to the pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics, but also the identification of futility throughout the course of treatment is an important aspect. The technical advances and possibilities allow us to continue treatment for maybe as long as we want or can. But after some time and after things have happened, that may not translate into a beneficial patient outcome. So to learn when the treatment is futile is of great importance, and future studies should help us with that. Another important facet is the identification of patients in whom ECMO has a great advantage during cardiac arrest and when there's no spontaneous recovery of circulation over time. Also, we need to learn about long-term outcomes of patients and how complications affect these outcomes. And we should focus to adapt the institutional facilities and chain of healthcare to measure these long-term outcomes and be aware of what's happening on the long run. This is a reflection of our work and the things we think that need to be done in the future. We thank you very much for your attention and hope to see you sometime and talk further about the topic. Thank you very much.